Good morning and welcome to the Catechism in Two Full Months. My name is Pastor Jay Lutz, and today we are going through article number 14, day 15. And so today I'm going to be reading on church order. So one place we see talking about church order is found in Titus chapter 1, verses 5-9. This is Paul speaking, a servant of God. The reason I left you in Crete was that you might straighten out what was left unfinished and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. An elder must be blameless, the husband of one wife, a man whose children believe and are not open to the charge being wild and disobedient. Since an overseer is entrusted with God's work, he must be blameless, not overbearing, not quick-tempered, not given to drunkenness, not violent, not pursuing dishonest gain. Rather, he must be hospitable, one who loves what is good, who is self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. He must hold firmly to the trustworthy message as it has been taught, so that he can encourage others by sound doctrine and refute those who oppose it. Here ends our reading. So, we see they're appointed, and they're directed to do such things. So we see this first talked about in the Osler Confession, Article 14. Concerning church order, they teach that no one should teach publicly in the church or administer the sacraments unless properly called. Yeah, so we're properly appointed. It's another way of looking at it, as we see in the scripture. And so what is the criticism or rebuttal to this? We see in the Apology, the Augsburg Confession, Article 14, in which we say that no one should be allowed to administer the word and sacrament unless they're duly called. They accept with the proviso that we use canonical ordination. Concerning this subject, we have frequently testified in the assembly that it is our greatest desire to retain the order of the church and the various ranks in the church, even though they were established by human authority. We know that church discipline, in the manner described by the ancient canon, was instituted by the fathers for a good and useful purpose. However, the bishops compel our priests either to reject and to condemn the kind of doctrine that we have confessed, or by new and unheard cruelty, they kill the unfortunate and innocent people. This prevents our priests from acknowledging such bishops. Thus, the cruelty of the bishops is the reason for the abolition of canonical order in some places, despite our earnest desire to retain it. Let the bishops ask themselves how they will give an answer to God for breaking up the church. We have clear consciences on this matter, since we know that our confession is true, godly, and Catholic. Small c Catholic, which means universal. For this reason, we dare not approve the cruelty of those who persecute this doctrine. We know that the church exists amongst those who rightly teach the word of God and rightly administer the sacraments. It does not exist among those who do not try to destroy the word of God with their edicts, but who also butcher those who teach what is right and true. Even the canons are gentler with those who violate them. Moreover, we want to point out again that we would willingly retain ecclesiastical and canonical orders as long as the bishop desisted from their cruelty against our churches. This willingness will be our defense, both before God and amongst all nations, present and future, against the charge that we have undermined the authority of the bishops. Thus, people may read and hear that despite our protest against the unjust cruelty of the bishops, we could obtain no justice. All right, so what is this saying? Well, this is saying that there needs to be good order. And that not only that, but it's not bad if there's church discipline in the matter of instituted for good and useful purposes. But when it's just a political thing, when it's just people picking favorites and being cruel, there's no place for cruelty in the church. As it says, In our Titus reading, it says, only those who are self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined, and who hold firmly to trustworthy message and sound doctrine. Right? And so this is what the reformers are calling for. That those who are appointed as elders, those who charged as overseers, might be trustworthy, that they might be blameless, not overbearing, not quick-tempered, not drunken or violent, or dishonest, but hospitable, lovers of what is good, self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. And so these are all the things they're calling. They're calling them back to the things of the Bible, that the Bible calls us as overseers, as pastors, to do. And so we take that claim seriously. So let's thank God for the church order, the holy orders, in order that we might have order within the church and that we might spread the good news of the gospel to all the worlds in love, in gentleness, in kindness. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly God, we thank you that you instituted those who are set aside to spread your word. We pray for all pastors and all leaders within the church, all bishops, that they would unite the church together and not spend their time breaking up the church. God, we just pray that those who are doing those things, those who are being cruel and unjust, God, we just pray that you might discipline them and bring them back into your fold, that they might know the love that you have for them, but also at the same time, let them know that it's important that we do not do as the world does, that we don't bring about division and animosity, that we don't let resentment or hate or hurt enter into our hearts, but that we rid those things within our hearts, that we welcome you and your Holy Spirit to break those chains, to bring about freedom and justice and peace for all. We thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks for joining me today.